You're listening to Neocash Radio. We discuss the future of money today. In the studio with you, it's JJ.
And Pedro.
Bitcoin will fork on August 1st. Lots of news out of Russia. Ethereum turns 2 years old. All this and more on episode 216 here on July 26, 2017.
In traditional markets, we have gold up to $1,261. Silver up to $16.61. Oil up to $48.70. The Dow is up to 21,711, and the 30-year treasury is up to 2.897%.
Thank you, Pedro. In the crypto markets, they were a lot higher earlier this week, but they're still up from last week. Bitcoin is up to 2514. Litecoin is up to $42.17. Ethereum is up to $203, and Dash is up to $196.58. Just a reminder that you can tune in to Neocash Radio every Wednesday night. Don't want to miss a single moment of awesome Neocash content, including special episodes and bonus interviews. Subscribe to our podcast on Google Play Music, iTunes, SoundCloud, Stitcher, iHeartRadio, YouTube, Podcast Addict, and more. Well, Pedro, this week we have so much to talk about, and we're going to start with, of course, the main story being Bitcoin. And I sort of have this this analogy or metaphor to sort of explain why I think what is happening with Bitcoin is actually healthy in a way. And that's, of course, my analysis of the situation. And we'll also give you the news. So it's easy to look at a digital construct and say it's a machine, but doing so ignores the most important element, the human using the machine. Machines, software, computers, and screwdrivers are just tools to be interfaced with a human. Sure, some tools will operate without constant human interaction, but they do so at the behest of a human. It is this human interaction that breathes life into a tool or computer and for a moment makes it seem as if this device were alive. This spark of life has made its way into the internet and now we have a massive network of computers all carrying that initial human action through a process. Through the network, people can interact, share, grow, and become something greater, a single cell in a much larger organism. We see the same phenomenon in our everyday life. Families grow, they multiply, and then they divide to repeat again. Businesses, clubs, organizations, they all do the same thing. They get so big, and then they divide. This pattern is repeated, and in each rendition, on an array of different scales. The group of people gets so big and then splits into two. This is no different for Bitcoin. The Bitcoin organism is comprised of thousands of humans spread across the world, each playing some part in the digital ecosystem. The fact is, the Bitcoin organism has grown so large that it must either evolve into the next form or split into two cells. This delay in this decision has simply raised the stakes by giving more weight to each action. Now that SegWit has been locked in and set to activate November 15th, the choice to evolve has been actualized. Unfortunately, this is a suboptimal solution for a portion of the Bitcoin organism. Too little, too late. As such, the organism will divide. This is a healthy and natural conclusion. The split is planned for August 1st through a user-activated hard fork. The plan is called Bitcoin ABC, or Adjustable Block Size Cap, and it will fork with a minimum 2 megabyte block. Initially, the blocks can be as large as 8 megabytes. The result is something called Bitcoin Cash, or BCC, and they claim to have already have code that includes replay attack protections and wipeout protections. The website claims to have optimized the signature hash function, which will improve security and eliminate the quadratic hashing problem. They also claim to have plans for adding additional scaling features beyond simply raising the block size limit. This effort is led by Chinese exchange via BTC, which is offering a futures market for the coming BCC coin. Currently, the BCC futures are trading for around $400. Well, what does this mean for Bitcoin? The Bitcoin blockchain will fork into two chains on August 1st. BTC will be the SegWit chain, and BCC will simply have larger blocks. What happens next depends on where the miners point their power. Now, what does this mean for you? Well, it really depends on where you have Bitcoin stored. If you have your Bitcoin in a wallet where you hold the private keys, you will be fine. When the fork happens on block N, you will own an amount of BCC equal to the amount of BTC you had in address at block minus one, or the previous block. If you have Bitcoin on an exchange or a hosted wallet, that exchange or service will decide what happens to your BCC. As one example, Coinbase have decided they will not be serving BCC. Anyone on Coinbase with Bitcoin will not have access to the BCC created by the fork. Check with your wallet host or exchange to find out how they will be handling the fork. What to expect after the fork and what to watch out for. Well, immediately after the fork, there will be a lot of uncertainty. The blocks may come out slower. Bad actors may use the opportunity to double spend. Transactions on one chain may be subject to replay attacks on another chain. But the main point is, do not send Bitcoin until you've separated your BTC and BCC into separate addresses. This is very important. And this is how you will avoid the replay attacks, or at least mitigate them to a degree. Now, BCC wallets may offer replay attack and wipeout protection, but not everyone is going to be using these wallets. In fact, protections built into wallets vary by developer. Unless you want to roll the dice, wait at least 12 blocks before you test the waters, and then be sure your first move is to separate your addresses that your BTC and BCC are at. Well, and you can also stay tuned to Neocash Radio. I will be putting out short updates before, during, and after the fork, and then we can discuss some scenarios, Pedro.
Yeah, well, this is it's a bit concerning because it is risky, because it depends on how much mining hashing power will go to BCC. What if very, very little goes there? Then a 51% attack is, you know, easier to do.
Right. Well, that's our first scenario to talk about. So let's say that the via BTC and the BCC only get about, let's say, 15 to 20% of the hashing power that's currently in the network. Well, then, as what you're saying, they would sort of they would be vulnerable to being 51% attack through a coordinated effort.
But is via BTC the only large mining operation that will do Bitcoin cash?
And here's the factor that's
because if they're the only ones,
there are miners that are still signaling and still indicating the SegWit activation, right? The 90 BIP 91. There's talk of Bitmain possibly supporting BCC. So let's talk about a different scenario. Let's say that via BTC and only about 15 to 20% of the hashing power moves over to BCC. And then maybe within some blocks or some hours or some days, other miners start moving into BCC because for whatever reason, they feel that is a better use of their hashing power. Okay. Well, in that case, it would seem like BCC would grow faster. In fact, blocks would probably start coming out faster for BCC and slower for BTC. See, that's really what you need to look at, though. There's only so much hashing power. And as the fork happens, the next blocks that come out will really affect the difficulty. So if miners wait until the difficulty is more set and then move, that will have a more drastic effect on each chain.
Sure. So if let's say I was a miner that had 1% and I saw via BTC move over 20% of the hashing power, and they essentially have almost 100% of BCC hashing power. So why would I take my 1% there? I would want to take my 1% there if I wanted to speculate that the difficulty is going to change to my advantage being on the BCC block, and I can get, 1% of all the Bitcoin that's produced on that block. And if I think it's going to grow on that blockchain, then I've locked in a lot of coin early on. So that might be one reason why somebody would want to consider that. But you're getting into that hashing power where the other giant miner via BTC has almost 100%.
Well, okay. So based on the current hashing power I'm seeing at blockchain.info, via BTC currently holds about 4.4% of the hashing power on the network. Now, my figure of 15 to 20% is including the idea that they're not going to be the only one. And I'm sort of using the
futures. Well, then
futures.
It's a showdown. Who else is going
to
jump in?
That's the thing. That's exactly what we're discussing in these scenarios of what could happen. And really, we don't know what's going to happen. But I think our listeners would appreciate just sort of an educated guess, you know what I'm saying, Pedro?
Well, I mean, again, there might be other miners that at the last minute might join in.
Right.
Because they along with via BTC, will have a lot of, most of the hashing power on that chain instead of their smaller percentage that they do now in BTC.
Right.
But that's risky because you don't have that distribution of hashing power evened out. So there is risk that one of those big miners can then do something, you know, take over the chain. I mean, why would they? They're not incentivized to, because if they bought their hashing power there, they don't want that blockchain to go away. But
right. And I mean, that's ultimately what we're talking about here, is the fact that it's in the incentives of the miners to do the what's in their best interest, right? So if it turns out that BTC is going to be the best bang for their mining power, then that's where they're going to go. I mean, the only thing that would sort of change that scenario is if it's an ideological decision. You know what I'm saying? That, like, if it was more based on, you know, the
Satoshi vision.
The Satoshi vision and that sort of stuff. So, well, you know what? We're going to keep track of this, and we're going to, as I said, I'll have some updates I'll be putting out.
I did want to comment on one point you made, JJ, Coinbase said that if you have Bitcoin at their exchange, that you won't get BCC.
Yes.
So what are they going to do with all the BCC they'll have when it splits?
You know what? I don't know, Pedro.
Do you think they're going to keep it for themselves?
Well, I think, you know, honestly, I don't know. I mean, maybe they'll try to burn it. I think it would make no sense for Coinbase to simply destroy the BCC rather than just wait a day or two or a week, you know, to just see what happens.
Or maybe, you know, the devil's in the details. Maybe they don't want to give you access immediately, but if they see that BCC chain rise in value, that they'll then compensate, you know, whoever had balances.
Okay, Pedro,
that would be the right thing to do.
In a scenario where the Bitcoin BCC chain has, let's say, 80% of the hashing power available, you know, that would have a drastic effect on the SegWit chain.
Absolutely.
So we're going to have to just see. We're going to have to sit down, buckle up, and get ready for the rocky road ahead, and definitely double check where your coins are and whether or not you have control of those private keys. So moving on, we have a bunch of Russian news here to talk about. And the big story up top concerns one of the oldest exchanges still in operation, or at least still was in operation, the BTC-E exchange. The owner was arrested in Greece, accused of a $4 billion money laundering operation. So Alexander Vinnick was arrested on a U.S. warrant alleging his involvement with a $4 billion money laundering operation. A recent USA Today article points out that 95% of Bitcoin ransomware payments were routed through the Bitcoin exchange BTCE. The exchange has been offline for more than a day and listed as under maintenance. There is little more information, and it is unclear what the status of the user funds are. So that's certainly causing shockwaves in the Bitcoin sphere.
I remember BTCE back from, you know, when Bitcoin expanded beyond, you know, Mt. Gox.
Yes.
And they've been around forever, and their chat box has always been very interesting to read. But they were always known as being, you know, kind of the pirates of the Bitcoin exchanges, and, you know, they were the place to go if no one else would take you.
Wow. Yeah, we've definitely covered them a lot during our run here in Neocash Radio. Moving on, Russia Airline S7 is using the Ethereum blockchain. In partnership with Russia's biggest bank, Airline S7 has begun ticket sales on the public Ethereum blockchain. A local media outlet, Kommersant, reports that the platform is designed to reduce settlement times between the airline and the agent. Now, they were talking about these settlement times were being 2 weeks.
2 weeks?
2 weeks settlement time between the airline and the agent. I mean, yeah, I think Ethereum can bring that down a notch or two.
And what's great about it is, so now we have, you know, airline tickets. In Germany, we have ability to pay for recharging, you know, electric vehicles. So really cool
and
stuff.
And what was it? Austria, wasn't it that the post office is selling ATMs now?
Yeah, now you can buy crypto through their post office and all their post offices. So that's really cool.
Well, Russian lawmakers are working to legalize initial coin offerings. Current regulations in Russia do not fully cover crowdfunding or ICOs. Lawmakers are hard at work changing that. The climate surrounding cryptocurrencies in Russia has been volatile, just like the currency. At first, they were ignored, and then they were attacked, and now it seems like Russia is in love with crypto. Well, I think they got it right this time.
There's so much potential for crypto in Russia. It's going to be
well. The
really
Waves platform
awesome
is really picking up with the whole biggest blockchain solution in Russia idea. So they do have a lot going for them, and they've streamlined a lot of processes. Well, good to see where they're going next. But in the U.S., Pedro.
Yeah, we have the SEC rules DAO tokens were securities. On July 25th, the U.S. Securities and Exchange Commission published a report of investigation regarding the DAO. Per the report, under the facts presented, the commission has determined that DAO tokens are securities under the Securities Act of 1933 and the Securities Exchange Act of 1934. In the accompanying release, the SEC explained that offers and sales of digital assets by virtual organizations are subject to the requirements of the federal securities law. The report provides four criteria that illuminate why DAO tokens were considered securities. First one is the foundational principles of the securities laws apply to virtual organizations or capital-raising entities making use of distributed ledger technology. Secondly, investors in the DAO invested money. Third, with a reasonable expectation of profit. And fourth, derived from managerial efforts of others. The agency has decided not to bring charges in the case of the DAO, but urges caution. Issuers of distributed ledger or blockchain securities must register their offers and sales, quote, unless a valid exemption applies, unquote. Unregistered offers could be liable for violations of security laws. Not all ICOs are securities. The Howey test, as articulated by the Supreme Court, one, is an investment of money, two, a common enterprise, and three, buyers expect profits from efforts of others. While not legal advice by any stretch of the imagination, we don't do that here at Neocash.
No, we do not advise people to buy, hold, or sell anything.
ICO best practices for those people to investigate on their own to prevent being classified as a security include consumptive use. AppCoin developers should consider building tokens with true consumptive value. An AppCoin has consumptive value because it can be consumed and put to real use with a decentralized product. This addresses the, quote, expectation of profit. Decentralized development and operation. An AppCoin developer should consider building products communally, which run communally or in a decentralized fashion. And finally, developer kits. AppCoin developer should consider selling a complete software developer kit. Selling just the coin misses an opportunity to point at real, tangible evidence that the thing you are selling is ill-suited for spectators and investors.
Wow, that's some good advice. So, you know, it's once again, they use the word investors, but once these people aren't, they should just say stick with speculators.
Right, of course.
But here's the thing, I think they're missing, and go ahead, Pedro, I'm sorry to interrupt you.
I was just going to say, you know, the SEC has given, you know, this stance, but, you know, believe you me, if they want to shut this down in the end, they will twist the words to make that happen.
You have certain coins, like, let's pay, pays, it gives you some sort of payment, right? But when you went to the IC or you look at their white paper, you look at any other document, there's like 7 pages of legal mumbo jumbo telling you that this isn't worth anything. We owe you nothing. So how does the SEC reconcile when the user agreement says you will get nothing?
Kind of like a ticket you get when playing one of those carnival games. They're not really worth anything. They don't need to give you anything.
Yeah.
If you only have the one ticket, they're not going to give you a fraction of a penny for it.
Well, we got more legal stuff we'll talk about later in the show, but for now we'll take a little break. We'll talk about the white hat hackers returning 95% of the funds lost to the Parity multi-sig wallet exploit. Well, following the wreckage of the latest security flaw, the white hat hacker group has returned most of the funds to the rightful owners. Last week, we talked about how an attacker managed to exploit a flaw in the code behind the Parity multi-sig wallet contracts. The White Hat hacker group was quick to respond and using the same exploit managed to save millions of dollars of Ether. If you are one of the few left to claim your funds, visit a link provided on our blog, neocashradio.com, to find out how to get your Ether back.
Yeah, the total amount, including the value of tokens, was, I believe, $208 million they were able to save.
That's a chunk of change for sure. I'm sure a lot of different developers are getting paid because of that. Unfortunately, Swarm City is one of the few who, I don't know, have they done fundraising or something? Or what?
I haven't kept up with that. I did know that the White Hat hackers have said they are refusing any donations whatsoever.
That's
so
right.
They are truly doing it to further.
So you know, if you see a donation link for White Hat hackers, it's a scammer.
Yeah, don't send it there.
All right. Well, hey, this week, since our last show, Pedro, I have done two different interviews.
You've been on fire, JJ.
That's right. So on Friday, I did an interview with the Tokes platform gentlemen, Michael and Gabriel, and it was a good interview. I'm really happy about it. They are looking to offer banking solutions to the unbanked legal marijuana businesses, and they're based out of Las Vegas right now, where Nevada is like selling out of marijuana and cannabis every day. Their stores run out. So it's a state emergency. Call the governor. So otherwise, I also did an interview with Lior Yaffe, I don't know that I'm pronouncing his name right, from Jalurida. And we talked about NXT Ardor and the upcoming ICO for Ignis. And it was a great in-depth explore. If you want to know what's going on with those systems, please check out that interview on our blog, neocashradio.com. Well, Pedro, we've got a news item right here.
Sure. One of the largest BTC coin mixers is shutting down. A surprise announcement came that the popular coin mixing service Bitmixer.io is shutting down. The founder of the service claims to have had a change of heart and wants Bitcoin to have a, quote, clean and transparent ecosystem without darknet markets. But several users on BitcoinTalk.org and Reddit are questioning whether this is a warrant canary, shutting down because of a government or legal pressure that they are not permitted to directly mention. Users point to Bitmixer's strange recommendation to use Zerocoin for privacy, a basically obsolete platform, and not something like Monero or Zcash. Coin mixing services are under great scrutiny from, quote, law enforcement, end quote. Let us not forget what was said at the large Interpol meeting in Qatar this January. Quote, all countries are advised to take action against digital currency mixer tumblers. Such services are designed exclusively to anonymize transactions to make it impossible for law enforcement agencies to detect and trace suspicious transactions. The existence of such companies should not continue to be tolerated, end quote. Well, duh, that's why people use those things, so that they can't be tracked.
Right, right. Well, another law thing here. This is just terrible stuff. So we mentioned the Uniform Law Commission last week on Neocash Radio, and how they were basically going to end up recommending the a New York BitLicense style framework. Well, they've went ahead and did that. So this is going to be sent at some point to Congress, and then somehow legislation is going to come about, which will probably be influenced by this, which it's sort of like, does the United States want to be in the dark ages of crypto? Like
there's already so many barriers in the U.S. You know, we have FinCEN calling it money. We have the IRS calling it capital. You have to follow both rules. This is bad. I hope this dies.
Yeah. Well, moving on. A man uses a 10X debit card to pay a toll, buy fast food with Bitcoin. It's happening, Pedro.
Very exciting stuff.
And you should check out, I did an interview with Dr. Julian Hosp probably a month and a half ago from the 10X debit card, and he talks about all this stuff. Well, it's actually happening. A resident of the Netherlands posted a video himself using his 10X debit card for the first time. He pays a toll, then he buys lunch at McDonald's. Both transactions are approved instantly, despite the delays usually associated with Bitcoin, and they appear instantly in a 10X wallet app on his Android phone. So there's a couple... news stories from 10X. So there was a write-up in Bloomberg that was mostly positive, and I think there was a write-up in Fortune that was mostly negative. But like I said, I interviewed Dr. Julian Haas. You can check that out on our blog at newcashradio.com.
Do you know if this means that 10X is live, or is this still like beta testing?
No, they've already beta tested. This is a live product that is functioning and working in the market, and they're apparently their pay tokens... I'm yet to see evidence of it or experience it, whatever, that the pay tokens will somehow pay you some amount based on the user's swiping, right? So every time someone uses their card, yep, a small transaction fee then gets divided amongst the pay token holders. I imagine it has to reach some sort of number before it even makes sense to dish it out. But I don't know if it's going to be something that just goes out, or if it's going to be something more like, for example... E for row has the dividend function basically, but you have to interact with the contract. You literally have to interact with their contract using a different function in your wallet. Most people aren't really that familiar with. But this is really good news, Pedro. The fact that a debit card is out there, obviously not in the United States, but it's out in the rest of the world, and people are using their coins and crypto to swipe and buy things. Like, that is one of the biggest barriers to mass adoption that needed to be overcome.
So remind me, with a 10X card, you don't need to pre-sell your coin to your currency. You hold
it in your 10X wallet app.
And when you purchase it does it on the fly.
Yes, your wallet app is then connected to that card, and you can even indicate which tokens you'd like to use first. And you have a lot of different ways that you can customize your scenario, and then clearly they put a lot of effort into it. So I'm really happy for Dr. Hosp and his team, and of course the rest of the people over at 10X, to actually have a working, functioning debit card out there right now using it's using this person used Bitcoin, but it should handle Dash, Ethereum, and ERC-20 tokens. So that is phenomenal news.
Absolutely.
Now the governor of Delaware signs a landmark blockchain law. The governor has signed a new blockchain law making it explicitly legal for companies to use blockchains for stock trading and record keeping. This is important because Delaware is a home to the majority of incorporated business in the U.S. This is a big, important story, and it goes against the SEC and the... This is why the states versus the federal government will not happen over guns. It's going to happen over crypto.
Absolutely. I mean, let Delaware do what Delaware thinks is best for them. And, you know, they obviously have, as you mentioned, a lot of businesses are incorporated in Delaware. So this is really good.
Well, New Hampshire's blockchain exemption law takes effect next week. Good news for us, Pedro.
It's been really cool here in New Hampshire. We've had a lot of good legislation pass, and this is a really good example of one. Yeah. The bill creates an exemption from money transmission requirements for persons conducting business using transactions conducted in whole or in part in virtual currency.
Wow, that's pretty blanket.
Yeah, that means, trading sites that... didn't want to do business in New Hampshire because they couldn't, you know, really comprehend the previous legislation, didn't want to go through the hoops, are now, you know, able to do so. So this is awesome.
Yes. Well, a couple quick Ethereum stories for you before we wrap it up here. Ethereum is turning 2 years old on July 30th, Pedro.
It's only been 2 years.
This felt like so much longer.
It really did. I remember getting into Ethereum when it went live on July 30th. And, you know, I've been involved in computers since, well, I shouldn't mention how long, but for a long time. And it was really, really difficult to get that client going. I mean, you had to download it, compile it. And I've done those things on Linux, but it was especially painful. So that first few days, I spent a lot of time going into the nitty-gritties of Ethereum and not understanding much of it.
Yeah, in fact, not only that, but when you were the whole mining thing of Ethereum too, like that, that was a new element, and I think it's really, to really understand the cryptocurrency, you kind of have to look at the mining aspect. You kind of have to understand what's going into it, and then to understand the technology being used to mine it, I think really gives you the full picture of just how massive this network is.
And when it went live, I mean, you know, I was mining it, and the coins were coming, but they, you know, weren't worth a lot, and unfortunately, I spent a fair amount of them. But in the early days, when that was the time that I remember, I was still doing mining of Bitcoin with ASICs. And when Ethereum started, I mined with my graphics card, and I'm like, oh wow, there's 5 Ether. At the end of the day, oh wow, 20 Ether at the end of the day. And little did I know,
oh, geez, Pedro.
I should have put those away for a rainy day.
That's your pizza money right there. well, we've got the Ethereum Enterprise Alliance is adding Mastercard and Cisco. Wow, the big stories just don't stop.
This is excellent. I mean, I've been on top of Ethereum Enterprise Alliance, and you know, adding Mastercard, and you know, especially Mastercard, but also, you know, Cisco is a huge company. So this is really good. And as a reminder to our listeners, so the Ethereum Enterprise Alliance is primarily financial institutions, and they want to use the Ethereum private version of the Ethereum blockchain running on their data centers to do, you know, business-to-business transactions. But they are committed to keeping the version of the code running in private with the public chain for the facilitation of talent, right? So there will be a lot of developers in public that they can then hire and such, so...
Wow, Pedro, it's exciting times. And as always, stay tuned to Neocash Radio this week for The Fork. We will be there to help guide you through some of the uncertainty.
We don't know
any better than you, but we'll at
Nail
least
biting.
Put ourselves out there. For Neocash Radio, this is JJ.
And Pedro.
Neocash Radio, where we discuss the future of money today. Check out our blog at neocashradio.com.